I can only do what my friend asked me to do.
Very foolish in my younger years.
Oh God, me too.
Because when someone says things about me, I can do it. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, very incredible.
Well, praise God. Some of you never heard me preach before. Now, I got to say, oh, first I got up for the Brother Spencer Sr. I love you, appreciate you. I'm here today because of you. A lot of people are here today because of you. Amen. And so your labor was not in vain.
Amen.
That's right.
Because I'm up here, you have the right to know things about me. David, I quit drinking again. April 30th of last year. Now I'm going to say some good things about myself and bad things about myself, so you understand, you can know the voice of God. You don't have to be a very special person. You don't have to be a great person. You just have to be a person that wants to hear the voice of God.
That's right. Amen.
God will talk to you, and God will deal with you as long as you allow him. Well, because I thought I was better, or thought I could do things. You know, we do this in life. We justify it, and we weigh the good with the bad. Well, because I got my eyes off of God, got my eyes on man, I started deteriorating spiritually, and I started smoking cigars, and I started drinking again. But God dealt with me the whole time. And this is, I won't give you the whole story, but the reason I quit drinking, God says, every time you put alcohol to your lips, you will vomit. I'm glad he did that. But you know what I said? Well, you know, I'm not going to drink that much. You know what I'm saying, Pastor? You know, that's the wisdom of man. And so I went to the Moose where my brother bartends, and I had my wife, you know, every time I love to go drink, she'd get aged and worried. But so I'm at the Moose, I ordered my first beer drinking, start talking and acting like a regular guy. And I ordered my second beer, and all of a sudden I started feeling sick. And I, after a sudden sip on that beer, I went home, and I'm like four blocks from the Moose, and Joe looks at me like, you're home already? Well, I started throwing up, and then I told her. Pretty serious price to pay, huh?
Mm-hmm.
But guess what? That's what it took. And God was letting me know, I playtime's over. Well, I didn't listen. I you know, with everything. And I'm smoking. Well, God dealt me with smoking. And I'm glad you God dealt me with smoking. If God's dealing with you, that's because he loves you.
Amen.
Well, I'm smoking cigars because I want to be a regular guy. I just want to fit in, go through life, you know, not be in the fishbowl like this. It's, you know, just be a regular guy. That's all I've ever wanted. You know, may have a little money in my wallet, you know, just be a regular person, pay my bills. Well, when God started dealing with me with smoking, here's what happened to me. Some great things, beautiful things. I got caught smoking at work with three people. I lost 3 days without pay for smoking at work. Nobody else got nothing wrong. And I was upset that God goes, I'm dealing with you, not them. 3 days of pay. And then the guy to come home and tell my wife. Well, guess what? I didn't listen then. So we went out on a church camping thing, which nobody in the church went with. You know, I guess we're all soft. So we're at the camp, at the long camping. And my brother happened to have been there that weekend. So because I want to have a cigar now in front of my wife, I decided I'm going by my brother's, I'm going to have a cigar. Well, on the way driving there, his dog ran in front of me. I hit the gas, not the brake, and I smashed into his truck. Most expensive cigar man has ever smoked. $2,500 worth of damage.
See how, if I would have just listened.
But you know what? But God was saying, hear me now. Are you listening? You know? And so I'm thankful God has not let go.
Amen.
And so something I'd like to do is fishing. And finally took God telling me, every time you go fishing, you're going to have a horrible experience if you small. Well, guess what? I went fishing and I lit that cigar. I can do this. And I'm fishing, I'm catching fish. And guess what the physical man says? See, I can smoke, I can be disobedient to God, enjoy my cigar, and I can still catch fish. Well, I went downhill quick from there. I went to Dave Sorensen, I believe. David got so bad, and Dave did not know that God was dealing with me. He looked at me and goes, the way things are going, the boat's going to catch on fire. I told him, please don't say that. Please don't say that. Because he didn't realize God was whipping me. So needless to say, I quit smoking because I wanted fish. And here's the blessing. Pastor Cheryl knows it. So now God's trying to get me right to get, so you got to be right to smoking and drinking, I was right. God never came up here in church because this is not playtime. People say, man, you seem so covered. This is my calling. So that's why I'm relaxed and come. I can do this because God's helping me do this.
Amen.
It's just that I would rather, in my fleshly man, not do this because I'm going to be no bigger than God. But in God's calling and God's plan, I can't be a bigger than God. So, Lord, help me to be who you want me to be. So we went fishing. We took Pastor Spencer and his wife out on Lake Michigan. And I love it out there. We did, it was a wonderful fishing experience because I was not smoking. God blessed us. We caught a lot of fish. But here's something that I know was God. I dropped a pole. If you don't know about Lake Michigan, they're fishing all the stuff off the back of the boat and the lines. And I went to grab this pole that a fish was on, and I dropped it in the water. Well, the boat captain's all bent out of shape like a pretzel, and he's, explaining to me how much money that pole was. I said, I'll buy you a new one. Because you know how much that is? I told him, I don't care. I dropped it. I'll pay for it. I'll be responsible. Well, Pastor Allen grabbed the other line to have a fish on, and when we reeled it in, he has the rod I dropped in the water. So that was God. But now, if I would have been smoking, them are the kind of things that were happening to me. Chaos. But being right with God, you tend to get the blessings of God. You know, this is just a Bible now. And my sermon I want to preach today, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. My goal, church, is to make heaven my home. Be exceedingly blessed. Why not? The horrible price that Jesus paid on the cross. The promises that he has if we do right. The things he wants for us, why not get those things? And I'm not talking materialistically, but to have the peace. Like you were saying, Pastor Cheryl, out of the mouth of babies, I was thinking. And you know what? I wish we as an elder could just say, pray for me. Because that's what Jesus wants to do. We have so many needs as adults, and right away we do all. We got all this other junk, and God came from our lives because we don't have that simple faith. You know, we run to everything else before we go to Christ. I'm going to go ahead and get bigger glasses eventually. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Now, these are scriptures that scare me. I want you to know, these are scriptures that spiritually sober me up. Makes me think, you know, because so many people, as hopefully the Lord will help me, don't take their salvation seriously. They just are going through motions out there, thinking I can do whatever I want, be whatever I want, because I'm saved by grace. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 1. Let a man, and this is you two ladies, so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Heavenly Father, again, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for never leaving me and never leaving any of us, Lord. We know, Lord, that without you, life is meaningless, Lord. But you, we're blessed, Lord. We're blessed, exceedingly blessed. And Lord, I pray today that people leave here, Lord, knowing who they are in you, Lord Jesus, knowing the gifts that you've given them, knowing the capabilities we have because of you, Lord. And just, I pray again for our pastor that he rests today. I'm thankful he's not here, Lord. I know people wouldn't understand that, but with him not being here, he's resting that foot, and we want him to be healed, Lord, so that he can work for you and serve you. Again, we just thank you for all you've done. Church, I'm a very touchy-feely kind of guy. I get upset. Well, I get up. Dave worked with me. How many? About 10, 15 years?
Yeah. He's seen the good, bad, ugly, the stupid, and the unbelievable, but that's okay.
But
all my life, I've been wanting to hear good things, you know, wanting the encouragement.
All my life, you know, I never was good enough for my dad, never good enough here. When I was in the Marine Corps, we never did nothing good. I get hired at a job, nothing's never good enough, you know? And I'm the type of guy I can hear, I can hear 100 good things, and then one person can come up to me and say, that was the worst sermon I ever heard. And destroy me, anger me, upset me. You know what I'm saying? Why can't the 100 things overcome the one thing? So I can be touchy-feely. So, and you know, God always has people by you at the right time. Well, my boss came in, Steve. We got one of them great notes, Dave. Clean up the yard, you know, this, you know, well, Gina sends it, you know, he probably and never typed any of the letters. But we got the letter to go out in the yard. It's, you know, time to get the yard ready, clean, edge, sweep, rake, you know, the whole shot. Because winter, you know, when winter gets over and the grass is growing. So me and my day shift custodian would go out there. And I'm just thinking we're doing more. Doing it, going to town, doing more than what we were told. And the poor guy gets out of his truck, he comes up to me and Sherry. He goes, just want you to know that you're doing an okay job, but, that's all I heard, the but. And then he started, you know, nitpicking. I tell you what, I was inside me, I was just feeling. Because the freshman man wanted to hear, man, if it wasn't for you, this school would fall apart. You know what I'm saying? I wanted man's approval. I wanted man's glory. I wanted, you know. And John Hill, good Christian man, not perfect. Good Christian man came up to me and goes, you know, Kirk, there's only one time that you have to hear, well done.
Good and
bad.
Amen.
Only
one time.
Amen.
And that actually made, that was the right words for me. Because no matter what he would have said about how good I know, you know, he could have said, you know you were better than that. He could have said all that fleshly stuff, and it still would have taken I want to rip the skin off his face. You know? Now, I'm just being honest with you. Don't tell me that people never, the first reaction to the fleshly man is revenge. Pain, destruction. You know what I'm saying? That's the fleshly man. And I'm ashamed.
Sometimes in my thoughts, I hear people say, well, don't you believe that person never did that? No.
because they're flesh and blood. And the fleshly man, his works are filthy rags. In me, there is no good. Church, in the fleshly person, listen, there's nothing good. I know who I am, but guess what? Now know this. I know who I am in Christ Jesus. Do you know who you are in Christ Jesus? Because you got to, if you don't know that, life will tear you up and destroy you. Because you'll just keep feeling unworthy, hopeless, and that depression will get on you and you'll be afraid to do anything. But there's a day coming when my name will be called. And Jesus is going to say, give an account of your stewardship. Does that mean I have to earn salvation? No. I am saved by grace. The book of Ephesians. Not of works. You know why? So no man can boast. I can't earn it. I'll never earn it. I'll never deserve it. But that doesn't mean I just. I'll tell you God the other day. He goes, yeah. I don't have to go to church. No, you don't. I don't have to put money in a plate. No, you don't. I don't have to this. I don't have to that. I don't. Because, you know, he was convicted. And I'm like, okay, well, I don't want the argument. So now I was thinking, I go ask the guy, well, how's that going for you? I had a conversation, you know. He's talking about how spiritual he was. But if I just do this, and I'm telling my wife, you know, I tell my, I'm, now she's going through therapy, so I'm treating her like a child. And I should still treat her like my wife, but she's not supposed to bend, she's not supposed to live, she's not supposed to do a lot of things. So I help her. And I tell her I help her because I love her. I'm trying to do things for her because I'm concerned about her. And if she gets better, guess what? I get better.
Amen.
You know what? Healthy wife, happy life. You know what I'm saying? I don't want my wife to be beat down and not walking or in a wheelchair. It could happen. It could happen. But if I just told her, I love you, honey. Never bring flowers. I love flowers. The feminine side of me would own a flower store because I love flowers. They're beautiful. And but if I say, you know, I love you, honey, and just sit in the house all day and just say, well, you know what, I don't have to talk to my wife to have a relationship. I don't have to do nothing for her, you know, But I care for her. Never lift a finger for her, never go make coffee, never like carry her purse because that weight on her shoulder is hurting, her tendons are torn. That little bit of weight hurts her. I'm like, you know, to me, it's hard to understand, but I, you know, when you listen to the therapist and then her back's bad, so that little bit makes her walk funny, which, you know, but if I never did none of that, how can I? What are good of my words?
You got it.
And this is what I'm doing to Jesus. I give thanks for dying for me, Lord, but where's my cigar? And where's my beer? That's what I was telling them. I want you to take care of me. I want you to answer my prayers. And I'll talk to you when I feel like it. I'll come to church if I want to. My calendar, I'm so busy, Lord. You know, God. I don't have to do anything well because I got this, and that.
The busier you are, the more problems you have, the more time you want to
have for God.
Amen.
But here, in Matthew 25:14, the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country who calleth his own servants. Is anybody who's not a servant of God to be serving the devil? I think we're all servants of God. You know what a servant is? I want you to think about it.
Somebody that cares. Somebody that does things.
And I hear people complain about service all the time. That restaurant, the waitress this, that is this. You know, they're always complaining about service. Well, I want you to know I've been blessed, church. Have been at some of the nicest restaurants. But I've also, as Sister Cheryl can attest, I've eaten food in some places that most people wouldn't even go and sit down. When we were in Nicaragua, the most expensive meal I had was not the $600 meal I had in Chicago 25 years ago. Four of us went, $600, that's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. Took my mom and dad. That was not the most expensive meal I had. You know which one we had? You ate it with me. We were in Nicaragua, and a family had us in there, and they couldn't do nothing for us. So they fed us their children's meals. And the pastor there, Brother Womack, looked at me. He goes, you know what this family's paying, how they're paying for this meal? They're giving you their kid's life. Because their kids had to go hungry that day. And they ate one time a day. So it would be like, if I ate your dinner tonight, that means today's Sunday. So Saturday night you ate, the next time you would eat is Monday night. How could you not eat that meal? You know how hungry, you know, you were there. It was painful! But Brother Womack said, they have nothing to give you except that. And that is, what a sacrifice. What a sacrifice. But church, I have been to some very good restaurants, and I found out over the years, you know when the service starts, it doesn't start when you walk in, it starts when you call for reservations. Yeah. When they make you feel welcome. We want your business, Brother Terry, thanks for calling. And is there anything else? You know, they do some good stuff when they're talking to you, that they're happy to be talking to you. It's not like those calls that we get, the robocalls and that, and they're calling, congratulations, you just won a trip to the Bahamas. You know what I'm saying? And puff, right, you know, they're happy. They make you feel welcome. And then when you drive up to the place, the valet parking, and everybody, from the time you get there till the time you leave, they are doing all they can to serve you. Serving is action. And sometimes serving is putting up with the bad customers. Amen. Or the unappreciated. You know, doing a job you don't want to do. Feeling like, you know, hurt, left out. So sometimes as we're serving Christ, we're going to have to sometimes just not feel as great as we want to feel, or have to make sacrifices we just don't want to do. But if I'm a servant of Christ, that means I am serving Christ.
Yes.
That's scary. And he delivered unto them his goods. We should all know this parable. I'm not only serving Christ, but guess what he did to me? Guess what he does to all of us? He gave me something.
Yes, he did.
Right? He gave me one talent. Another person, I think, got two talents. And what was the most? Five talents? One person got... But whatever, there was three sets of talents. Not all of us are going to get equal. But it says in the scripture here that God gave to us according to our abilities. So whatever he gave me, he gave it because I had the ability to use it. So I was thinking, you know, Lord, what do we all have? Because, you know, some people can say, well, if I get this, this guy, you might get this. And some of you here, as you serve the Lord, we all tend to face the same things. Maybe not exactly, but the same kind of situation. I cannot believe how many people have came up to me and Joe says, if I had what you had, or if my life was like yours, you know, in other words, you know, we got it so good, that's why we're serving God, and they don't have it like us, so they can't serve God. Well, God gave you something based on who you are and what your ability is, so you can prosper that gift and make it work. Now, here's a couple things that we all have. Except for Mr. Phil back there, but he can still communicate. We all have this. We all can talk, but Phil can still communicate. What does the Bible say that are in our words? Life and death. You have the gift of life. Oh, now the devil's going to say, yeah, you got the gift of death too, and you have killed people. You know I've crushed people with my words, my wife, people I love, people I work with, because of the fleshly man. How many have I given life to? We all have that gift. Some of you are so calm and relaxed in like bad situations where there's hysteria, you know, where there's maybe a bad accident or there's been a big fight, a lot of emotion going on. I don't tend to handle them well because I'm emotional. But some of you could maybe go up to somebody that just lost a child, lost a spouse, just the suicide path, these horrible, horrible things, and be able to sit down and speak life to that person.
Yes.
What? Is there anything greater than that? And I guarantee you, some of you here, you have that gift to where no matter what's going on, you are able to sit down and talk to that person, or maybe just listen, and you can minister that person and put hope and life back into them to where they're not destroyed because of the situation they're in. I'm not the owner of what God gave me. Now, I have bought gifts that have been not well received. We exchange gifts in here with my brothers and sisters. Does anybody exchange gifts? You pull the names out of the hats and you don't know who we're getting. Well, I got my sister Nancy one year. More than once, but this one year I got her name, and you know, she's always has a list. She's very good. I don't have a list, you know, so if I don't get something I like, it's my own fault. I don't give a list, you know. But she had the list, and we go shopping, me and my wife, and she's buying for whoever she picked. Well, I got my sister Nancy, and I bought an expensive pair of what were they, Joe? Slippers, you know. And then, because I like to joke a little bit, I bought her one of those sesame seed characters where you push them that makes noise and talks. A gift you would buy a kid. Phil, you laugh. You could see what's going on. I could see you doing this to Mary. Well, my sister opens this gift, and guess what? Oh, it was ho-ho-ho time! She was, oh, man! She was lit up! Didn't appreciate the gift, that's all she saw. So the gift, the real gift I bought her, didn't matter. She saw the gag, and she swore to the family, revenge. That day, next Christmas, and the next Christmas, and the next, you know, because it hurt, she was offended by that gift. And of course it wasn't used. I wonder if the dog chewed it up. I don't know. But the gifts God gives us are precious, are valuable. And here's what we do to them. Ah, okay. Put it right there. I think we ought to be honored, as flawed as we are, that God is entrusting us with gifts. Me! It's
for you that don't know what I did for a living. I was a custodian. Humbling experience. And this teacher came up to me and said, what kind of a church has a janitor as a pastor? And I allowed those things to cause me to just do this. Instead of knowing who I am in Christ. You know, I like the simple words, which really shouldn't destroy us, but words come the light right out of me. But what an honor that God has entrusted me with not just one gift, more than one gift. If all of you here, you've been given a gift, and you know what? If you don't know what the gift is, please find out by prayer, by seeking the Lord. God will do things. I'm going to show you this. Now, we were at the meeting. I went to the meeting for the trip with my wife. And you know why I went with her, Pastor? I'm sorry to say, because I don't trust her. Now, you know what I'm saying? She's not, and what I mean by that is she's going to do more than she should. She's going to walk, bend, do, and her back's going to be out. You know, and I am so excited. We're making progress. Almost every bone in her body is out of joint. My thumb hurts, and I'm a crybaby. I'm not lying, Sister Diane. Her whole body's that way.
Okay, let's go on.
Okay, but anyway, so I went to the ladies' retreat, and they set me up with one card because they knew where I was going to sit. Well, I'm going through the lunch line. And, you know, I told Pastor Cheryl, when she was over by my mother-in-law's house, I said, God gave me a message. And then I was talking to Sister Guy at the ladies' retreat because I know the voice of God, and I know he laid a message on my heart. And then he was laying some other ones, and I like, okay, I need to really consider getting back to where I'm supposed to be. And then here's what I pulled that out of the box. Pretty cool, huh? You know what? Not that I needed it. That's a scripture. About from Isaiah, where it says here, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. I didn't need this because I already knew. But I pulled this out, and some people say, oh, what a coincidence. That's why I don't put my trust in this card. I put my trust in one God. But it's stuff like this. God will let you know that, hey, here it is. He's going to confirm things in your life. It's not going to let you just walk in the dark and grope and hope that you're doing the right thing. He will let you know that you're doing the right thing. And he'll confirm his word. But church, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is here.
Amen.
No, it's here, isn't it? Do you know that scripture? The Bible says the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. If the Spirit of God is living inside of me, then I should not be failing. I shouldn't just be getting by. What does Philippians say? I can do all things through Christ that gives me strength. What God has given me, I can do because it's Him doing it. In church, it's Him that justifies it. We don't have to worry, and we do, I do. I need to not worry about what man is saying about me or to me to confirm who I am. I need to be worried about what is Jesus saying to me.
Amen.
Am I doing what Jesus wants?
Hello.
I want to please me. That's the biggest battle. The biggest battle with being up here, this is easy for me. All my life I've been able to stand in front of classrooms, and I don't know if it's because I want to be the center of attention or what, I don't know, but all my life I've never had problems talking and being with people and demonstrating things. So this part of the calling is easy. The hardest part is walking out them doors and letting people know that's a minister of Christ. That's a man that fails. Mm-hmm. And then dealing with people. I wish I had what Pastor Alan Spencer has, the ability to just, it seems like nothing bothers him with people.
Oh.
If I had those, Lord, help me with my people skills. So when people are making me upset, I still treat them the same way when they're making me happy.
Yes.
And I have a hard time, church, some of you might have this, I have a hard time forgiving myself.
Yeah.
I hate myself sometimes, and that's the enemy, you know. Because if I hate myself, if I can't forgive myself, I'm going to be like this, I'm going to be like my favorite song. If I was a mole, I would crawl up in my hole, then I would be a mole, all alone in my hole. How you like that one, Phil? That's how I would rather be, alone, you know what I'm saying? Away from living under a rock, with nobody bothering me. And if I get out of rock, there's the lake with the boat. You know what I'm saying? But that's not what God wants us to do. We are in the people business.
Yes.
And I have to be involved in people if I want to hear, well done.
Amen.
It's not easy, church. But I'll tell you what. Start looking at this. My next sermon, wherever it is on addiction. And it's sad when you look addiction up on a computer.
That thing like cell phones.
Video, all that technology junk. That kids actually go through withdrawals and have been sent to the emergency room because they are sick. Because they don't have that thing in their hand. And they're not communicating that way. Boy, did the Lord whip me when I was not reading this as much as I should have. And the Lord said, how many hours do you read the paper? I love the paper. Because, you know, now we got the, 24. But when I was first saved working with Dave on third shift, I get the paper and I love looking at it. I love reading it. Wouldn't miss reading the paper every day, but guess what? Miss this. Look at the prophecies. Start doing some studies on the return of the Lord. Look what's going on, church. I just saw a thing today. And if I was this guy, I would have it done. Paralyzed from the neck down, they put a chip in his brain. Computer chip, Brother Jerry. And now he's learning how to use that computer chip by his mind, and he can move his right arm.
Oh.
And he's got feeling. Now if I'm paralyzed, I don't want to be paralyzed. You know what I'm saying? Praise God for medical science, because if it wasn't for medical science, a lot of us would be in the grave right now.
Yes.
Because of what people die, the things that people used to die. You know, but, and look at this, what's going on in the Middle East. I don't know who it was, I'm not going to put a name on it, but we all can relate to this. How many times have you given change to younger people and they can't make it? We complain they can't even give you change at McDonald's. Have you heard them stories? You know why? Because I worked in my elementary school. They're not teaching the kids to make change with money because they're making, they want them to get used to the cashless society.
Okay.
Pull out You know, your phone, like it cracks me up. Poop, poop, the phone. You know, all these things that people do. But you break out cash. Talking to Joe's therapist. And I tell Joe not to do this because I know they can't handle it. The bill is $6.10. So you give them, or $5.10, and you give them $10.10. $5 back, right? And they're going, they can't figure it out. You just made it easier on them. We were just in Canada. The American money's better than the Canadian money right now, so I was happy. I was blessed, Brother Jerry. 75 cents bought a dollar. So, you know, that's 25%. That's a good profit. Wish my market, I wish the market was doing that for me right now. I had to go to the land. But I asked the lady because they would take American and Canadian money because they were right across the border. She goes, I would rather not have you give me the paper money because then she's got to figure it out in her head. What's, you know, what's the, you know, the exchange rate of what's, but she had a machine. We put our credit card in there. And if it was a $100 Canadian meal, let's just say, it would show $75 on the bill. Because it did the conversion for her. Simple, cashless, you know what I'm saying? Technology is just church, I know this. That whether I go by the grave or I go in the air, I'm going to be standing before the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And even though I'll never earn it, never deserve it, and probably never really be comfortable, I want to hear him say, well done.
Yes.
Church, you're blessed. You're equipped. You're great. You're better. And what you a lot of times tell yourself, what your friends tell you, your family might tell you, what you tell yourself, you are a victorious person. Because of Christ living in you. Whatever that gift is that you have, or the gifts, use them. Because somebody desperately needs that gift that you have. So they can someday also hear you all done.
Hallelujah.
Pastor, sir. Or should I dismiss?
You want to take anyone off
prayer? Oh, and yeah, that's a good thing. Would anybody like to have prayer?